Yeah, thank you very much for the invitation to give you the possibility to tell you a little bit on how we deal with beavers back home and try to squeeze a one-day training program on mitigation in 25 minutes presentation. So if you're missing something, you can ask me questions. And as far as I'm aware, listening to the histories of beaver introduction in Scotland, which I said is a history you presented, there are a lot of other stories around, and you mentioned, I think most of the beavers roaming around here, their grandparents and grandparents, I had him in the hand, came into Berwick, he brought him to the quarantine station, he brought him to enclosures here, and well, beavers are damn smart animals. It's very, very difficult to build an enclosure that keeps them in. The first beavers brought to Bavaria in 1996, when we introduced beavers back home, they had a nice enclosure. It took the beaver one day to build the other side of the fence. So it's in their blood. A short history of beavers in Germany. We have only a few survivors. As you know, beavers were extinct almost completely out of the 100 million that roamed Eurasia. Maybe 1,000, 2,000 were left. We had about 120 left in eastern Germany. The only reason why they were left, the area was just too wet to do anything else. You cut firewood and that's it. So the beaver survived there. And survival of the beaver is, the rest of the beaver happened. Food, parrot, and Castoreum as remedy. The survival of the beaver is, as with many, many projects in nature conservation, often due to single persons that push everything. With beavers, it was an Amtmann bear. You can see him here with his early version of a smartphone camera. We took a lot of pictures of beavers who promoted the protection of the beavers, who also invented the beaver rescue hills, where beavers when flooding, floods the lodge. They can sit on top of the rescue hill, look around, wait for the flood to go, and go back to the lodge. We still use the hills today as beaver and other wildlife rescue hills in the floodplains. The 200 beavers spread slowly. There were translocations already in the 30s to other areas in East Germany. 1996, Bavaria started with a big release. We had about 120 beavers released during the course of 15 years. We had, in the 70s, relocations within East Germany. In the 80s, 90s, a couple of more relocations and releases in different parts of Germany. The last official one was 2004 in the Rhine area next to the Netherlands, where they met the beavers coming from the Netherlands upstream the Rhine, and we put them in downstream. And to be honest, we also got quite a number of helpful releases by different peoples. And nobody knows exactly where the beavers are coming from, but all of a sudden they popped up somewhere. And that increased the speed they've been recovering Germany. Right now, population, beaver population in Germany is around 40,000 plus, maybe 39,000, maybe 42,000. East Germany is more or less completely settled by beavers, the same Bavaria. We got the southern part of Baden-Württemberg settled, and in the rest of the areas, we got population of a couple of hundred up to 1,000, 2,000. Beaver is now a strictly protected species. When they were released in Bavaria, it was a game species. Legal responsibility for beavers is with normally local county agencies. They're responsible for about 1,000 square kilometers, and 1,000 square kilometers, that's between 100 and 350 beaver territories. So if the people at the administration do something about beavers, they know their region. So it's not a Bavarian government talking about beavers 300 kilometers away. It's really local knowledge that's dealing with beavers. The only state that has not yet have beavers is Bremen in the north. There's a little red point right next to it, but it didn't make it over the border yet. So what was the reason for success? When the beavers were released in Bavaria, everybody thought, okay, in the long run, we're going to have maybe 500,000 beavers left. The beavers are species that's living in floodplains of big rivers. That's it. Nobody expected the beaver to spread over the country. Because the beaver is a fascinating species, but it's a very primitive rodent. All he needs is water and food, and the rest he does himself. All the other species, if you change their habitat, they go away, they go extinct. The beaver turns around, builds a dam, and recreates the habitat. So you can put in, if you got a question many, many years ago, how would you release beaver in England? I just, no problem, take 50, throw them on your lawn. They're going to survive, they're going to spread. We have beavers, if you look at the top left picture, that's the beaver living in the floodplain, sitting on a nice lodge. You can also beavers lying in the middle of arable land. They just build a dam, they got the water level they need. And from a beaver point of view, it's even better life. In the floodplain area, you have to live off all the nice nature conservation and nature species. You get prime food, high quality food, corn, maize, sugar beets. You don't spend walking around half an hour, an hour, feed. You go out, take a sugar beet, go home and eat it. The same to the right, sewage plants, good habitat for beavers. You got beavers downtown Munich. That's a German technical museum in Munich, in the middle of the city, 1.5 million people. You got beavers. And that's probably the most natural living beaver in Bavaria, in the middle of the city. Because the city, the houses, he doesn't care about. All he got is the water and the gravel and the riverbanks. There's no fertilized grass bare farm in his territory. He lives what's growing on the riverbanks. And if the flood washes it away, he has to move to a new place. So aside from the flood regulation in the area, this beaver is living like the beavers a couple of thousand years ago. So every beaver in the other areas who can go out of the sewage plant in the ditch, swim 50 meters, get food on arable land, is much more impacted by humans than this in the middle of Munich. And beavers, although they dig burrows, of course, they also like to use burrows provided by humans. Why waste your time digging a burrow if you've got a nice burrow? If you've got a walk, with a dam in front of it, swim in. And while the other ones on the top left are still working on their house, he's already having fun because he's done. The problem with beavers, they don't ask. They just go there and start to make their living. They build a dam, they find an area, they cut trees. And that, of course, causes problem if it's on private land. They feed on corn, they feed on crops, they cut trees, they cut the apple tree that planted, they cut the tree that's falling on my house. They dig a burrow under the road, they dig a burrow under arable land, the dam, a nice pond, but I don't have a pond for my garden. I don't have a pond for my cornfield. So the beaver been busy in Bavaria, and nobody knew what to do with animals. Beaver was strictly protected. Back then, it was one of my first projects, looking at how many beavers we got. We had between 800,000 beavers in Bavaria, not very many. They're strictly protected, and now they cause problems. What do you do? You're not allowed to tax them. The law says, do nothing. And then, of course, the farmers, they got angry if their field is flooded. The mayor of the community who spends money to repair the holes in the road, he got angry. And then we developed a beaver management, and also, once in a while, if I'm in the wild, I watch beavers 99% of the time. I'm working on this, working with people. The beaver doesn't need management. He's been living for 50 million years. He knows what to do. Not a tell him what to do. It's the people who have to learn how to live with the species. Not only with beavers, we've got a wolf management plan, Bavaria. We've got a bear management plan. We don't have a bear, but we've got a bear management plan. We've got some otters, we've got otter management plan. We've got a moose coming once in a while from Czech Republic. They got their own management plan. None of the management plan is read by the animals. It's read by the people, and the management is, how do you deal with the animal? In Romania, they got thousands of wolves, thousands of bears. They do not have a bear management plan. They've always had bears. They know what to do. And here in Germany, we have to write it down, everybody can read. If you got a bear, let him go and don't try to kill him. Because if you kill him, it's
your problem is not their problem. So the goal is coexistence of man and beaver, not in some nature conservation sites where the beaver tourists, it's coexistence in all of Bavaria, Germany. So as I mentioned, jurisdictions with county nature conservation agencies. Dealing with people costs time. The agencies don't have the personnel to do everything. So we train in the business now 500. We train a lot more because the ones we trained 20 years ago, they're old and 78, 79. So they retire from retirement as field manager. They're doing most of the job going out, talking to people, and see when there's a problem, how can you solve it. We got to be a manager, my colleague Horst Schwemmer is doing Northern Bavaria, I'm doing Southern Bavaria, and we are doing mainly public relations work, training local consultants, going out and when you have a bigger problem, or a more political problem, or if an area there's a new problem that the local people consultants didn't have to do anything last year, so we just counted what we do in this case, so we help them in their ongoing work. We also got guidelines for beaver management or the management plan. It's a guideline just writing together what does the beaver do, what are the problems, and the most important thing is, okay, that's a nuisance problem, but who pays? So where do you get the funding from? That's to support the local agencies, beaver consultants. There's all the regulations for damage compensation and when can you trap beavers. We put everything together in a handbook for the local beaver consultants. You can get it on the internet, www.beaverhandbook.de, and it's also in the English Beaver Management Handbook, a lot of the things. The system we developed in Bavaria is now also adopted by other administrative districts in Germany, where they also do training of local beaver consultants in Baden-Württemberg, in Hesse, in other places, to start the business, and when it's running, they do it themselves. We have four pillars in beaver management. One is consulting people doing public relations. Because a lot of beaver problems come from just not knowing. You have a new species, and then it's a change. I don't know what's going to happen. So I'm against. If you have a fisherman who's afraid that the damn beaver is eating his trouts, of course he's against beaver. But if you can tell him the beaver is definitely not eating trouts, but if the beaver cuts a tree and fells a tree in your pond, that's a coverage for the fish. That's against cormorant getting the fish. That's for the small fish hiding between the little branches for the big pike and it's a small trout. Then, of course, you've got a completely different view of the beaver. You just have to tell the beaver what he does. The next pillar is preventive measures, so everything you can do to keep the beaver from causing problems. That goes from buying areas up to similar things like protecting trees, putting up an electric fence. We have also damage compensation, that's not in all of Germany. We have now three regions, Bavaria, Brandenburg, and Mecklenburg, where you can get damage compensation if the beaver causes flooding, if he feeds on your corn, you get money from the state, and we also have the fourth pillar, that's removing beavers in places where the damage might be too big and you don't have any preventive measures to keep the beaver from causing damage. What we've learned in the last years, and that's for us it was clear from the beginning, the best solution is to create space along the rivers. Beavers normally use 10 to 20 meters. Of course, if they flood an area, it's a little bit bigger, but from the water, 20 meters into the land, that's what the beaver uses. Of course, if the beaver is in a lower quality food area and you've got sugar beets 300 meters away, he's definitely going 300 meters. So if you go, get a sugar beet, come back, it's worth going farther. But that's a few things. If you take the river in 20 meters, that's beaver habitat. So set asides along the creeks, it's for lots of reasons. It's against pesticides, against fertilizers, against the sediment of the creek. It's for the development of creeks, so creek meander. That's exactly what a water framework directive says. A more natural creek, that's not a stretch of river. It's a river and land around it where the creek can work. It's for water retention, it's for many other species. It's for rebuilding groundwater tables, it's for flooding protection. The beavers like a cornfield more. So if you're a beaver on top and on bottom, if on top a little bit further up you've got a cornfield, if I'm a beaver, I'd rather go in the top area. Because it's much better food. It's good for nature conservation, it's good for all the other reasons, and it's good to solve a problem with the beavers, but the beaver likes it. As we do, live as easy as possible. And that's a service that landowners can provide to the public without globalization pressure. You might get corn cheaper from Canada, you might get your steak cheaper from Argentina, but if you want to do something for flooding protection in Germany, you have to do it here. And it's your land, and you give the land to the state for flooding protection. You don't have any pressure from a farmer in Canada who is producing cheaper corn. Of course, it takes time to get the land. You've got a number of different programs and funding. How to acquire land along the creeks. So where do you get the areas from? The famous goat from England. I want my money back. And that's exactly the same principle we got. We want our land back. System is maybe different in England and in Scotland. You got hundreds of thousands of hectares of strips somewhere along a creek, along an old road, that's owned by the state. You just don't see it. That's plowed by the farmer. So in theory, if you look at the land available, owned by the state, I could make a 20-meter strip to the right and to the left on each of the 6,500 beaver territories in Bavaria without any farmer having to give away a square millimeter of land he owns. Just have to give back the land he's illegally using. And that's not only in Bavaria, it's over all of Germany. So we just have to get the pressure to get the land back. If you have to buy the land, there's money available, we have compensation sites, so if a community develops housing development, they have to have compensation sites. If a big company opens a new building, they have to have compensation. And another big point is money from flooding protection. The right is a picture from the area I'm living. In 2013, we had a flooding. To be honest, I think thanks God they were flooded. Because the forecast where I was living was 50 centimeters above dam, that we would have been flooded. Thanks God, the dam broke further down, they were flooded, and the water was running off from our area. Cost around 500 million. If you take only 200 million out of this 500 million, that's 40%, and you invest it in flooding protection areas, along creeks, along rivers, you spend the money one time. And the area can be flooded next year, in 5 years, in 10 years, in 50 years. If you don't do it, you're going to have another flooding in the village in 5 years, in 10 years, in 20 years. It's much more expensive to do nothing instead of really spending the money for things which are useful. Of course, you can do it in short time, you can do it everywhere. We've got a lot of number of things that work very, very good to keep beavers off what they want to do. One of the best things is erecting fences. The people got one big disadvantage. He's wet when he comes out of the water. So he gets him an erecting fence for a week, and the people knows it's a no-go area. You can protect trees with mesh wire, with painting. You can protect pipes, cheap and simple. Instead of the pipe being blocked, the people can only try to block the fence, which is much easier to remove the material and much cheaper. We have beaver deceivers. You are allowed to remove beaver dams. The most expensive is to protect dams and dikes. In the beginning, the water management said, okay, if the beaver builds a bullet and a dike, we shoot the beaver. Problem is, the burrow is still there. You have a dead beaver, and you still got the water running in the dike because the burrow is not removed by the beaver bird. And all you do is create a free territory. You get a new beaver coming in, causing the same problems. Then they started to have other methods. They put in mesh wire, and when they put in mesh wire, they looked at all the burrows in the dikes, and they found the biggest burrow in the dike they wanted to protect was not beaver, it was badger. So they said, okay, we need a safe dike, no matter whether you go badger, koipu, muskrat, fox, rabbit, they all dig burrows and we dominate a hole in our dike. So what they're doing now, they make the dike digger proof. We also got damage compensation, not everywhere in Germany. It's mainly for people making a living out of land, that's farmers, foresters, commercial fish hatcheries. It's useful but often misused. So if you want to have damage compensation to solve a problem, so if you have 500 euro damage, you get the money and there's no reason to complain about beaver anymore. You need clear regulations because about a third of what we pay, that's not beaver damage, it's just an attempt to make extra money. We have about ability to remove beavers in case of severe problems, and if you have no or too expensive preventive measures, you need the permission of a local agency. You also got some general derogation, for example, for sewage plants. We don't want to have a beaver. A sewage plant is to clean the water, not to give a territory to beavers. Normally, the beavers are trapped and then killed. You also got direct shooting. If you got the beaver, you can use it privately, so you can make your beaver head, you can make a beaver jacket, you can eat it. You're not allowed to market the beaver. Last year, 2018, we had about 2,000 beavers removed in Germany. Out of 2,000, we had about 1,600 Bavaria. That's compared to a population of 22,000. But if you look at some of the figures I've heard about Scotland, we got 450 beavers removing 200. That's 50%. In Bavaria, it's 7%. So that's a little bit different. And to be sure it's a permanent job, you always have to check whether you've got a new beaver coming. We also got beaver management plans, where each beaver territory gets a color. The green one are the ones where there are no problems, or minor problems. So you just let the beaver do what it wants to do. The opposite, the red ones, that's the places where we have severe damage. It's very, very expensive to prevent the damage, where it may a couple of years before you can do something. That's where you trap the beavers. And you've got the yellow ones, that's where the beaver is. It might cause a little bit more problems, but you're not trapping the beaver, you're coping with the problems, you're protecting the dam, you're putting in beaver deceivers whatsoever. So this system, in theory, is for politicians and for the public. That's three colors everybody can understand. And it shows nothing else what the people are doing anyway. They just put a red dot on the place where you've trapped beavers, and when you know there are beavers and didn't do anything in the last 20 years, you give them a green spot. The most important is public relations work for the long term. Many conflicts, as I mentioned, arise from not knowing what the beaver does, how you can get help, how you get money for the solutions. So we're doing presentations, we're doing field trips, we've got a beaver exhibition going around in nature conservation clubs. The best place for a beaver exhibition is a bank. Because the bank, everybody goes. Even people are not interested in beavers. They go to the bank and they learn about beavers. If you put up the beaver exhibition in a place like here or at the meeting point of nature conservation agencies, you reach the people who are interested anyway. But you have to get the other ones. We have press articles, letters to the newspapers, book, brochures, and also put together a beaver backpack. So if you do a field trip, you just take a backpack and you put everything in the backpack you need to show the people. You got a beaver pile, you got a beaver skull, you can take the teeth and size out of the beaver skull. So just tell them what the beaver is. Because it's the people that make the difference. And you can be pretty sure this young lady who got the chance to tell us a beaver, she won't be against beavers. And she will tell her roommates, her colleagues, and maybe even her parents to keep pro beaver. Another thing is here, this beaver here. If you go to a farmer and you know the farmer got two children, you bring two of these beavers to the children. And you can be pretty sure they gonna work for the beaver, telling the daddy, the beaver is not the bad, look at him. He's so cozy. We got ways to find out the stuff about the beaver platform, beaver tours, leaflets, and signs in the wild. If you pass by, you can read, okay, that's a beaver lodge. What does the beaver do? Why did you build a lodge? What you also have to do, respond to nonsense. That's a rather new article from June 16. Okay, that's according to our law, you cannot show the people. And you have to describe the name. So this lady, it's a farmer. She was saying, well, it helps nobody that we will have to import food from China because we protect the beaver. So you protect the beaver, he's eating the corn, and 5 to 10 people die of starvation. If you don't do nothing, this nonsense is spreading. The truth is, 1/3 of all the stuff farmers produce in Bavaria is thrown away. That's waste. That's garbage. And if you think it money-wise, for the taxpayer, you pay the farmers 3 billion a year, and 1 billion of the subsidies they get is to produce garbage. And if you bring this in a presentation, it's very interesting. You see the farmers getting angry, and then they look around, and there are 5 farmers and 25 other people, and the other people think, but we're spending money for prison garbage. It's not a problem for farmers. A lot of the garbage production is after farming, with convenience food is whatsoever. But it makes more sense to change our use of the food instead of chasing beavers off the ground just because they eat a little bit. And you all might ask, where is the beaver problem? Our Christian social party, it's still the big party back home. It's not like in England where you're up and down, though. So Christian socialists are on 40-50%, though they're always in the government. They're normally against beavers. If you look at beaver damage in Bavaria, we have €650,000 reported beaver damage, which is, of course, everything. We also have beaver damage in communities or in private areas where we don't pay compensation. So it goes up, €650,000. On the other side, the beavers save several millions. I think Chris, you brought the example from the beavers building dams and lowering the cost of a man-made dam for flooding protection by a couple of €100,000. So that's 1 year beaver damage compensated by one family. And we got 6,000 beaver families back home. So in the long run, the beaver makes money for the state. On the other side, we got this guy here, and that's my example now in our presentation, the German Minister for Traffic and Transport. He developed, and already the guy before him, they developed a toll system for German highways, which is completely illegal. To charge only the people not coming from Germany, but they charge everybody. But if you're coming from Germany, you get your money back. If you're coming from Austria, you pay. That's not what the European Union says. You know, it's clear to everybody that it's never going to work. Nevertheless, this guy has spent 50 million at least, if you take all the other stuff, at least 100 million, or several hundred millions, on this fake toll system. So where is the problem? Is the beaver the problem? Or is this guy the problem? And if somebody says, well, we have to kill beavers, reduce beavers, they're causing too much problem, just kind of okay. Reduce beavers, they cause problems. What do you do with him? Causing more problem and more damage. We also have, well, as you know, we've got public relations for the body, the beaver cake. The middle is a more advanced beaver cake with a marzipan picture on it. The one on the bottom left, that's from Switzerland, they're a little more exclusive, they've got beaver champagne. The Castel Bleu. And to be honest, it's very good. And if you look at the right side, that's definitely a beer bottle. And that's a pretty good way to make pro-beaver PR in Bavaria. Because in Bavaria, you're going to have the people drink the beer and keep the bottle, and that was on a kind of Woodstock festival. And if everybody got a beer bottle back home for the Woodstock festival, you know the beer is a good buy. So, in beaver management, you should use the chances. Sometimes you have to remove a beaver if the problem is getting too big, but beaver are a keystone species, creating habitat for many other rare species. It's an indicator species, not because a beaver is here, it's good outside. If you've got the beaver and no problems, that means you don't have only water, you also have land next to the water. These are flagship species. We've got hundreds and hundreds and thousands of species, small insect species, doomed to extinction. even gonna have an English or German name, you don't get a single cent for protection of them. But if you got the beaver killing a tree, and the tree is used by the beetles for the next couple of years, he's creating the habitat for them. And the beaver is a nature engineer. He can work on the Water Framework Directive. He's got 50 minutes experience how to make a natural river or to make a natural creek. That doesn't cost a single cent. All you have to buy is the land. And the land you have to buy anyway if you want to do the Water Framework Directive. You cannot go into the ticket on private land if you buy the land. But then you can keep the dip back home. Let the people do the job and save hundreds of millions in the course of the next decade. So thank you for your attention.